Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Varun Soni. I'm the Dean of Religious and Spiritual Life here at the University of Southern California. I'm so grateful to welcome you all to our panel this morning, Religion in the Public Sphere. It's so wonderful for this first event to see so many people here. Do we have any students here by any chance? All right. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. We always want students to come, but then we schedule this during Coachella, and that makes it harder. Before we begin this morning, as you know, we're asking you to turn off your cell phones. This morning, we're going to be exploring religion in the public sphere through the idea of secularism. Here in the United States, secularism is often thought of as a complete separation of religion and the state. Indeed, the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment maintains that Congress shall not endorse or establish a religion that has, that has implications across almost every aspect of public life. But by saying there can be no religion of the state, American secularism also says there can be religion, all religion in the public sphere. And that plays out in all sorts of ways, from foreign policy to presidential elections to what happened right here this week at USC, where our student valedictorian was basically precluded from giving a valedictorian address, and it's sent shockwaves, honestly, through our community and heartbreak. And so secularism is messy, it's multifaceted. There are many ways to think about it too in different contexts and different traditions. And so today we're extraordinarily lucky as the NBA playoffs begin. We have our own extraordinary all-star panel here of USC professors to discuss the role of religion in public settings and spaces and the relationships between religion and culture, politics, and identity. We're also celebrating new book releases from our three esteemed panelists, so I suggest you buy copies of their amazing new books for yourselves and for your 10 best friends. I promise they will love you forever if you do so. You can purchase the books upstairs after the session right above us. It's signing area 10, and our authors have kindly agreed to hang out after the event to sign and memorialize your book. So please, please, please take advantage of that, because after all, this is a book festival, and you should go home with some really nice, new, inspiring, empowering, enlightening books. Our event will unfold in the following way. First, I'll moderate a conversation with the panelists. Then we'll open it up for Q&A and discussion. And afterwards, we'll have our book sale and signing event. And now it gives me great joy to introduce you to my friends and colleagues. Dr. Sherman Jackson is the King Faisal Chair of Islamic Thought and Culture and Professor of Religion and American Studies and Ethnicity right here at the University of Southern California. Prior to that, he spent many years at the University of Michigan's Department of Middle East Studies. He is the author of numerous books, including Islam and the Black American, Looking Towards the Third Resurrection, Islam and the Problem of Black Suffering, and Sufism for Non-Sufis. Routinely named as one of the world's 500 most important Muslims, he is the preeminent Islamic studies scholar in the United States. Today, we celebrate the release of his magnum opus, The Islamic Secular, which was published by Oxford University Press. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Sherman Jackson. Sitting next to him is Dr. Duncan Williams, an ordained Buddhist priest in the Soto Zen tradition, who has spent years piecing together the story of the Japanese-American community during World War II. A renowned scholar of Buddhism, he has taught at UC Berkeley, UC Irvine, and Trinity College. He's currently the director of the Shinso Ito Center for Japanese Religions and Cultures right here at the University of Southern California. He is the author of 6 books, including his most recent called American Sutra, A Story of Faith and Freedom in the Second World War, which was published by Harvard University Press. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Duncan Williams. And sitting next to Duncan is Dr. Diane Winston, who has spent over a decade as a journalist and is now associate professor of journalism and night chair in media and religion at the University of Southern California, right here at the Annenberg School. She is the author and editor of several books, including Religion in Los Angeles, Religious Activism, Innovation, and Diversity in a Global City, which I might add is the course book for my undergraduate course called Global Religions in Los Angeles. We are here to celebrate the release of her brand new book today as well, called Writing the American Dream, How the Media Mainstreamed Reagan's Evangelical Vision, which was published by the University of Chicago Press. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Diane Winston. All right, Sherman, I'm going to start with you. Congratulations on this incredible accomplishment, your new book. In the United States, we often think about secular as being completely disconnected from the religious. But in your new book, The Islamic Secular, you offer a different approach to the secular that is not in opposition to religion, but rather complementary to it. Indeed, your book outlines a vision for the religious secular, which for many of us in the West might seem like a contradiction in terms. What do you mean by the religious secular, and how do you contrast that with the idea of American secularism?
How long do we have? No. First of all, thank you very much, Varun, and not just for your kind introduction, but for everything you do here at the university, often without the recognition or appreciation that you deserve. Let me just preface my comments with a bit of sort of contextualization with regard to my overall thought on this issue. Back, I think it was in the 30s, Sigmund Freud visited America. And when he talked about his experience here, he said that America is a mistake, a giant mistake. And by that, he meant that he didn't feel that it was possible to bring people from different races, different backgrounds, different historical narratives, different religions into a single space to constitute a nation. And I think that one of the things that presses on me, I assume it presses on some of you as well, is what's right wrong? And I think that the burden of being able to accommodate each other in all our diversity is still something with which we struggle today. And what's happened recently at this university with the denial of the valedictorian, the right to speak, is really reflective of that. I think that we all have to recognize that there's a price to be paid for who we are as American, as Americans, that the American project comes with a price, and we have to have a civics that is taught and modeled that will empower us to be able to handle that burden. The decision that the university made, to my mind, is not that civics. And so with that, let me go into your question, Varun. First of all, I mean, my book, the concept of a religious secular, I mean, it comes out of a really careful rereading or reexamination of the Islamic intellectual tradition, particularly Islamic law, at the heart of which, of course, is Sharia. And to make a very long story short, the book is over 500 pages. Maybe I shouldn't say that, you won't buy it. Bang. to make a very long story short, there are two ways in which you can look at this. The first is how Varun sort of laid it out, about how this maps onto the American space. I think that the emergence of the category secular in the early modern West was basically designed to create a space and to police a space in which we could be free of divine dictates, dictates that come from God as expressed in scripture and that tell us how to live our lives, particularly in the areas of politics, science, and economics. That secular area was an area in which we could proceed, handle our business completely free of any sort of encumbrance by what God has to say. Even if we were religious in the domain that's cordoned off as secular, we could proceed as if God did not exist. And so the secular was a non-religious domain. It's a domain where what God has to say is not relevant. And what that produces is two possibilities, one of being religious or secular. The two can coexist, but you have to turn to one and then turn to another. They cannot inhere in one in the same act or person. Based on the Islamic legal tradition, and I think this is really important because the stereotypes about Sharia or Islamic law is that it is totalizing, all-encompassing, it covers everything, and therefore it cannot accommodate any space where we are not dictated to by God's commands. What we come to understand from a careful reading of classical Islamic jurisprudence, going back 1,000 years, this is not my innovation, it is a rereading of that tradition itself, is that Sharia is actually bounded. All right, it is actually limited. And the idea that Sharia covers everything does not mean that there's an explicit rule for everything. What that means is simply that everything can be judged by Sharia's categories of classification. And I'm going to be very brief, don't worry. I'm an academic. Okay. But you have these classifications: obligatory, recommended, neutral, discouraged, and forbidden. The idea that Sharia covers everything means simply that everything can be placed into one of these categories. It does not mean that Sharia dictates a concrete rule for everything. All right? And so what we have is many rules of Sharia, all right, that don't tell Muslims everything they need to know in order to actualize the practice of Islam on the ground. All right? So if we take the economy, for example, Sharia will say something like, it's forbidden to charge interest on loans. Okay, all right. That dictate, however, does not tell you everything you need to know in order to establish and run an economy. What do you do for the things that Sharia does not dictate? Well, you engage in reasoning, all right, that is to all intents and purposes secular. All right? It's secular in the sense that it is not dictated by anything that God has to say. All right? Having said that much, Muslims still see themselves as operating within a sort of sacred canopy. That is to say that the divine gaze, the watchful gaze of God, all right, is ubiquitous. And so even when I'm engaging in secular reasoning, I'm doing so in the context of the watchful gaze of the God of Islam. And it's this combination of engaging in secular deliberation, using secular reasoning, but within the context of that sacred divine gaze, that we end up with an Islamic secular. What makes it Islamic is that it is still engaged with the idea that I must do this in a manner that is not displeasing to God. But God does not tell me everything I need in order to establish an economy. Now, the significance for this in the context of America is that if we take the main issues that divide us right now, let's say, what is it, the immigration? No? Gun control? Healthcare?
Reproductive rights?
We'll get back to that. Well, part of reproductive rights. No, my point is that there are issues on which Sharia pronounces, all right? But on the majority of the issues that we are confronting in the political discourse today, Sharia has no concrete rule at all. And what Muslims will be doing is engaging in the same kind of secular reasoning that non-Muslims would be doing, all right? Although Muslims would be doing it in the context of the watchful gaze of the God of Islam. What this means is that religion then, or Islam then, is not an impediment to public discourse, all right, over these kinds of issues. And the idea that I may be committed to Sharia, all right, does not mean that I'm bringing a concrete rule on immigration, a concrete rule on healthcare, a concrete rule on gun control into the public domain. Is that okay?
Professor Winston, I'm going to move to you. In your new book, Writing the American Dream, you investigate the role that religion played in getting Ronald Reagan elected for a second presidential term starting in 1983 for the electoral season, which of course, you know, ended up being a landslide victory. In doing so, you posit a religious imaginary that provides a baseline for a political ideology that offers citizens meaning and purpose and identity through civic values. Can you expand upon this idea of the religious imaginary, especially in terms of how it engages a more conventional understanding of secularism in the United States?
Okay. Can you hear me in the back? Yeah. I want to go back to what Professor Jackson said about Freud's comment on the United States being an impossible dream to fulfill because of our differences. And that's an excellent starting place for a description of the religious imaginary. What I posit in the book is that a religious imaginary is what holds us together as a nation. It's a common belief in our destiny as Americans. And it's been expressed through the centuries in different ways. One of the more recent and poignant ways is Ronald Reagan's idea of a shining city on a hill. Reagan believed God blessed America and we would be that shining city on a hill. And to Reagan, that meant we would be a model for freedom and democracy for all the world. And we'd do it in a way that would show the world that these goals were possible. That idea is one that you do not need to be a Christian, a Jew, a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim, and even an atheist to ascribe to. It's a belief that any American can ascribe to because the shining city is a city for all people. And the religious imaginary that I believe has held us together is one where we see our common project as being a beacon unto the world of these gifts. Now the problem is, well, what do you mean by those gifts? And what I suggest in the book is there has been a shift between seeing these gifts that were God-given, and I put that in parentheses or quotes, as either being based on a belief in individualism or a belief in communitarianism. FDR, when he was president and introduced the New Deal, basically was reminding us that we're all in this together, and if one person needs uplift and relief, give it to him. And so I would say between the 30s to the 70s, that was our idea. And you could see it enacted in the differential between the salary of the head of a corporation and a worker was obviously different, but it wasn't like wildly exponentially different. People had a sense of restraint and of giving to others, which isn't to say that everybody was like the most generous person in the world, but it is to say that people saw limits to what was right and wrong in terms of public displays of wealth. Ronald Reagan, when he came into office, had a very different perspective, and it was much more based on the idea of freedom and democracy being individual, all about the individual. This goes back to a Protestant sense of the idea that the individual is in relation to God, and salvation is always an individual process. And we can always talk about this, but Reagan saw God's gift to us as individual political freedom, which means limited government, individual market freedom, which means no regulations, and individual religious freedom, which means basically I'm free to express my beliefs in the public square. So if I don't want to make a cake for a gay couple, I don't need to make that wedding cake. So it's an idea of religious freedom that's not quite what some of us may think of as religious freedom, but it's an idea today which is called religious liberty. So Reagan put forth these ideas, and the media, which plays an important role in all our political thinking, not because the media tells us what to think, but it tells us what to think about. Reagan's idea were normalized through the media's constant repetition of them, because whenever Reagan spoke, he would often refer to these ideas. And for example, when Reagan spoke about the Soviet Union as an evil empire, he was turning a geopolitical fight, the Cold War, into a cosmic struggle between good and evil. And that is a very different spin on how we think about our international relations than what is typically thought, than what was typically thought of until that point. So I posit that Reagan's change of the religious imaginary and this idea, it was all about individual rights and individual responsibilities, began to unloosen or unravel the social cohesion, which kind of made us think of the shining city as a city which is obviously full of individual people, but who have a common goal. And to me, the election of Donald Trump was the apotheosis, the shining moment of the triumph of individualism, because here you have someone who cares about nothing, and if you are a Trump supporter, I apologize now, but here we have someone who cares about nothing but his individual rights. And here we have someone who has told people, whether their perspectives seem anathema to public cohesion, that their ideas are okay to be expressed in the public square. And now I'm thinking about very hardline Christian nationalists. And I think that this bears upon our current situation, because our concern with our own individual rights have made it harder for us to come together and think of ourselves as a collective body. And in a collective body, there are certain sacrifices you make for the good of others. And it bears on the current situation in USC, at USC, because we are denying someone, we have denied someone the right to say whatever she was going to say at graduation, because others of us a priori felt whatever she said was going to be problematic without even knowing what she was saying. And I think if we were to take a step back, we would see that all of us have the opportunity to be heard and to be listened to. Obviously, hate speech is something different, but I don't believe that the university would have selected someone in the first place who was going to engage in hate speech. That she was vetted enough, to my mind, to believe that this would not be a speech which would have broken the campus apart. So I see Reagan's move to, he believed he was injecting evangelical principles in the public square. I think that he did us a grave disservice by making us more concerned with our individual rights than our collective responsibility. And I believe that you do not have to go to Washington to see this in action. You can just come visit us at USC and see how religion in the public sphere has become so misunderstood and so abused that we have come to the point of denying 22-year-olds their ability to share their wisdom with us.
Okay, Diane's a friend of mine, I think it's unwise to forfeit the opportunity
to benefit from her when she's provoked. So I wanted to just mildly push back, just ask a question, because I think that, I mean, what you're saying about Reagan, fine, but I'm not sure that the individualism, the hyper-individualism that you're talking about is an exclusively conservative orientation. I think the problem that we have is that it's on both sides. I mean, if you listen to a liberal like Martha Nussbaum, who says, liberalism says, we're not concerned about the whole. We're concerned about the individual and how the individual is faring. And so you have it on the liberal side and you have it on the conservative side. And I think the problem that we have now is that none of us see a way out of this. We've been given this from both angles, and now we have to try to find some way out of this. How can we become a more communitarian-oriented society?
I must not have communicated clearly, because obviously this is a problem that is not just a conservative problem. My point is that Reagan was a conservative, and he was the one who put this in action. But obviously, liberals, moderates, all of us, to some degree, have bought into it. And I think you and I may disagree on this, but it also fits very well into the religion of the market. And I believe the market becomes its own spiritual center for people. And I think this is the problem in our nation now, that there is no religious imaginary that can cover us all and give us a sense of what is right, what is wrong, how do we live together as a people. And that's across the board, not just conservative, but liberals as well.
Thank you. Dr. Williams, in your book, American Sutra, you chronicle the mass incarceration of Japanese Americans during World War II and the role that religion played for both the state and the community in that process. And of course, you know, not only the Korematsu decision in the Supreme Court deny 120,000 Japanese and Japanese Americans the basic right to habeas corpus, held them without any charges, and ultimately led to zero arrest, but it also targeted Americans on the basis of national origin and religion. And so can you talk a little bit about what role religion played, and especially Buddhism played, in the government's assertion that Japanese were disloyal? And how do we think about that if we're living in a secular democracy where that on its face seems unconstitutional?
Okay, I'll try. Let's see. You know, when I was doing the initial research at the National Archives about what happened with the Japanese-American experience of forced removal and unjust incarceration during World War II, because I think, as Varun mentioned, there was no due process, you know, to the incarceration of over 125,000 persons of Japanese ancestry. I was really surprised to find that the very first person that was picked up by the FBI was Reverend Gikyo Kuchiba, head Buddhist priest of Honpa Honganji Buddhist Temple in Honolulu, the largest Buddhist temple there. And the Japanese American community at that time, during the eve of Pearl Harbor, was a predominantly, like about 78% Buddhist community. But it shocked me that why would you not pick up like consular officials when you're at war with a nation, or maybe, you know, members of the Japanese, you know, former veterans of the Japanese Imperial Army or something like that. But it was a Buddhist priest. And the second person they picked up was, I belong to a Buddhist school called Soto Zen Buddhism, and our temple head priest was taken as the second person. And then they got to those other people eventually. So I was like, how come, you know, Buddhist priests are deemed such a threat to national security? And what I would come to uncover was that both, you know, national origin and race played a factor in the targeting of this community, but also religion. That somehow the loyalty or the ability of Buddhists to feel, not to be seen as American, as a part of the American community, that exclusion of persons of basically, you know, Asian ancestry with the Chinese exclusion, like there's a long history of exclusion based on race. But even that, you know, they were called the heathen Chini when they first passed that law. It's not just race, but religion. The fact that they're not Christian played also this double factor of being deemed a threat to national security. And once Pearl Harbor happened in Hawaii, they actually declared martial law. And one of the first things that we found out that without the protection of, you know, religious freedom, the constitutional protections, what happened? Entire islands of Hawaii, Buddhist temples, Shinto shrines were shut down and banned. People could not gather at them. And usually, you know, you're not, as a government, as Varun was saying at the top, the American government's not supposed to tell you what church to attend or, but that's exactly what they did. They said, if you're Japanese American, you need to have a feeling that you need to attend, you know, some kind of house of worship on Sunday, you're allowed to go to the Japanese American Christian churches, but not to the Buddhist and Shinto ones. So that's what happened in Hawaii under martial law. And in the United States, continental United States, of course, there was the forced removal from people's homes. It didn't matter if you were a US citizen or immigrant, didn't matter if you're a little baby or an infirm grandmother. Usually you wouldn't think of those type of people as a threat to national security, but every single person, the architect, chief architect of the incarceration process, Carl Bendison, put it, if you have a drop of Japanese blood in you, I don't care. He was talking about these orphans at the orphanage. He said, if they have a drop of Japanese blood in them, I want them in camp. And so that's how thorough it was, this forced removal and placement into these camps for a time indefinite, for, you know, at least if you go to prison, you've been judged by a jury of peers, or you've been accused of a crime, or you have a sentence, you know, number of years you have to serve. They went for a time indefinite to these places unknown. And in 1943, going to that loyalty question, they actually, the United States government administered something they called the loyalty questionnaire. And amongst one of the questions was your religious affiliation. And if you answered Shinto on it, they said there will, the effect of that was there would be no chance that you would be able to ever exit the camp. Right? If you answered Christian on it, you got plus 2 points. They would give you different questions, and then they would add up plus and minus points. They give you plus 2 points so that if there was an opportunity, let's say the Supreme Court ruled on, you know, the Korematsu case, and okay, like these other cases, and they said this is unconstitutional, you could be amongst the first to be exiting the camp. Buddhists got minus one, right? So there was clearly a ranking in government officials at that time of who belonged and who didn't. And so getting to the bigger question, I think that both Sherman and Diane have raised about the secular, I think the big question people faced, I remember one family experienced when they entered camp, one of the first things they did, it's like entering prison, the guards will check your luggage for any contraband. And, you know, you think like, okay, if you have guns in it, they would confiscate that. If you had a camera, apparently they were worried about espionage, they would confiscate. But the other thing they would confiscate, like if you had a Buddhist sutra, or if you had any, in fact, any book with the Japanese script in it, that was considered contraband. And they would confiscate. And the only exceptions to that was if it was a English-Japanese language dictionary, you know, where you had needed both languages as a dictionary, or a Japanese language Christian Bible, that was okay. So the message that people understood in that era from the American government was that to be seen as loyal, to feel like you're less of a threat to America, was to speak English and be Christian. And so I think the bigger frame that I tend to think about these issues is thinking about this, again, all the way back to the Chinese exclusion. Like, there's a long history, well before World War II, a really long history of a question between, is America essentially, foundationally, a white and Christian nation? Or is it a nation of multiplicity ethnically, religiously? You know, is it a nation of religious freedom and thereby pluralism? Or is it one that is singular and supremacist in its formation? And I guess the way I tend to see things, based on what I learned in my research about what happened to Japanese Americans during World War II, is that America has this history that's like a pendulum. At times, it's a very open and multiple and welcoming of pluralism and the multiple voices and, you know, that question, the Freud thing that was raised. And on the other time, it swings the other way and becomes singular and exclusionary, and certain forms are seen as superior to, like, and that our history is this pendulum back and forth. And so, to me, what Japanese American families did, I'm going to mention the last thing. When that one family figured out they were going to confiscate everything, Buddhist sutras and things like that, what they did was they had an American flag left in their suitcase, and they had a small photograph of a Buddha. And on their barrack wall, they put up the American flag and this Buddha. It was their way of saying, I'm going to push the pendulum back to our vision that you can be both Buddhist and American at the same time. And I think that's maybe one of the lessons from that experience, is that we are living in, it's not like there's one, we have two different visions of what is America, and we swing one way when certain people do certain things. And back then in World War II, some people stood up and, you know, said America can be more than just one people, one religion, but can be multiple. And so I feel like that's maybe one of the lessons I take from that history.
Well, I have so many questions, but I'm sure you do as well. And so in the interest of time, let's move to our Q&A, and then I'll give the audience member a chance to, the panelists a chance to sort of offer final reflections at the end. You can ask a question, if you have one, to any of the panelists individually or to the panel as a whole. There are microphones going around, so I just ask that if you ask a question, you speak into the microphone so everyone can hear you. And let's start over here. Yes.
Thank you. For Dr. Winston, thank you very much. I'd like to ask you about whether you see the current moment religion as corrosive to what you've aspired to, or as constructive. In particular, I'm thinking of the schism in Methodism and the conservative side that is exiting from the United Methodist Church sees the United Methodist Church as having gone in the direction of individual liberties on sexuality and that sort of thing, and that they have betrayed the collective Methodist identity. I'm pushing back a little bit because I see a lot of groupthink on the conservative side, accusing those transgender kids and the others of going in atomized directions. So just wanted to ask you about that.
You know, it's amazing to me that the UMC, the United Methodist Church, is still fighting this issue 40 years after I first covered it. Which says to me this issue must be a lot more salient than I myself believe it should be. it's always seemed to me a question of revelation. And this is true as much with our founding documents as it is with the Bible. Do you believe revelation is a constant and is always occurring? Or do you believe revelation happened once and it must remain that way forever? I think that question is hard to reconcile when people feel so differently about it, about the changing or unchanging nature of revelation. I also think that if we truly believe in fellowship and communitarian ideals, we find a way to work together despite our differences. For me, when the division becomes more important than the communitarian ideals, something is wrong with the body itself. And I believe that whether we're talking about religion or about our current political situation. So I think I am not a United Methodist, so I'm not inside this debate, but in my most hopeful of hopeful dreams, I would wish these people would be able to talk to each other rather than at each other and see that their beliefs should be stronger than their differences. Do you think I'm an idealist? I tend to be an optimist.
You're in the back.
Hi, I'm Carla. I'm a staff member here at USC, and I've done a lot of reading and listening and everything. Hi, you all turned around. I'm wondering if you all could talk a little bit about where you see the prosperity gospel fitting into American life, either currently or kind of evolving. And I especially kind of heard it, and for me it stood out when Professor Jackson and Professor Winston was talking. So I'm just curious of where you think that fits in and if it kind of contributes to the white Christian privilege that happens in the country. If that made any sense. If not, disregard.
Okay, this is me personally. I think that the prosperity gospel is an example of this individualism and market ethos gone crazy. And I think this is what is debilitating our country right now in terms of the desire for self-aggrandizement, whether it's my rights or I need more money or I need more things. So the prosperity gospel, as I'm sure you're aware, is a gospel that teaches if you give to God, God will give back to you. If you tithe to God 10 times, God will give back maybe 100 times to you. And that idea of religion seems to me utterly anathema to what religion ought to be. And it also speaks to me of the corrosive effect of, you know, a market economy.
Thank you.
Do you want to fight me on that, Sherman?
I don't want to fight you on that at all. I think that I was a little curious about what you saw and what I said that had, you know, that touched upon the prosperity gospel. But I would add one little thing here. I agree with you about the corrosive nature of the prosperity gospel, but there's an extent to which I also see it as another form of sort of conspicuous consumption on the part of minority groups who sort of mistake a false sense of identity, a false sense of dignity for a real sense of dignity. In other words, that the dominant culture has told us that we are inferior because we do not have. And therefore, by gaining, we come to put ourselves in a very different light vis-a-vis that dominant culture. In that sense, money is sort of playing the substitute for God. And so I think in that way, the prosperity gospel is very corrosive to me. But it was Henry Adams, grandson of President John Quincy Adams, once said that to do America, or to try to think of America without the clue of race, is to produce nursery rhymes. And so when we think about things like the prosperity gospel or anything else, we have to think about it across racial and other lines in such ways that it may have different resonances here from what it has there.
Can you hear me well?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you very much for this discussion. And my question is maybe related to secularism and the harmony or the opposition between religious world, as you pointed out, and secular world. And you know, look a bit what could be special in America versus other continent. I'm thinking about Europe. We come from Europe or Asia eventually, although I know less. You're coming from Europe. You know, secularism and religion seems to me have been much more harmonious, you know, world. There is much more harmony between the religious world and secular world. You could not imagine, if you just think about the way European countries pass abortion law, end-of-life law, assisted suicide, same-sex marriage, without very much turmoil. And so I think Europeans would have a hard time to understand that abortion here become a major political issue. And so you refer to Ronald Reagan, you know, and I'm really wondering whether in the history of America versus Europe, there is some other element that could explain that major difference that you pointed out and I thought very interesting. I'm thinking about the Enlightenment, you know, Rousseau, Voltaire, you know, did not have major influence in America. But I don't know when you see other elements in the deep history of America that could maybe explain that type of disharmony.
I feel like I've been talking a lot, so I'm gonna. I'm not scared of the question. I'll answer.
Sherman, I feel like you have perspectives on.
Oh no, they want me.
Oh boy. first of all, I'm a little mystified by your description of Europe in terms of religion and the secular being so harmonious. I think that from the perspective of many Americans, and myself as a scholar, I think most people would think that the secular has sort of subjugated the religious in Europe, and that's where the quote-unquote harmony comes from, and it's really a very false harmony. So I'm a little mystified by, you know, what you see as this magic balance. I think that with regard to the other question you raised, look, I think that to some extent, yeah, the issues we're talking about are religious, but they're also a matter of what our civic culture is. And by that I mean this, we're always going to have people who say X is good, X is bad. The question becomes, do we have a process for negotiating our difference over X? And are we willing to live with the prospect that I may lose in that particular competition? Now, the competition can't be rigged so that I'm guaranteed to lose or that I'm guaranteed to win. And that's why I stay in the competition, because I might win. I might actually get my way. But any of us who have strong convictions, I'm not sure it makes a difference whether those convictions are religious or not. They're strong convictions. And if we have a civic culture that does not allow us to negotiate strong convictions, we're going to end up where we are right now.
Coming from a very different perspective, it's important to remember that our founding fathers of America were very conscious of the religious wars that had occurred in Europe. Mm-hmm. And for that very reason, they devised a system of government where religion would not be part of the governmental structure itself. given that situation where we never were a religious nation in the formal sense, and we had people of all different religions coming here, we kind of developed what's called a marketplace of religion where everyone could be in competition with each other for winning people to their religion. So the basic dynamics of religion in Europe and religion in America were different from the get-go, where there one had an established religion and another didn't. One had, Europe had homogeneous populations. Mm-hmm. We had diverse populations. So they're really, the difference in how we approach the secular and the religious today, I think, is a product of those historical circumstances.
I very much agree with you, Diane. And I think that, I'm going to say this, and hopefully we can just let it pass, something to think about. But I think that, you know, we keep using this word religion. And the fact of the matter is that not all religious communities define or understand religion, that category, in the same way. I think our understanding comes from a sort of a European Christian background. And part of the challenge we have now is whether we're going to assume that as Westerners that we are restricted exclusively to a European intellectual heritage in terms of how we negotiate our issues moving forward. Could we come up with more capacious understandings, for example, of the category religion, all right, that may differ from that definition coming out of a European background, but do more of the work that we needed to do in an American context?
I have been thinking about this as our discussion has continued, and what we seem to forget is, broadly speaking, Protestantism is the only religion where individualism is validated and sanctified. If you look at Islam, if you look at Judaism, if you look at Buddhism, Catholicism, they're all about how you live your life, how you conduct yourself with others in the world, how you maintain yourself in corporate relationships, in communal relationships. So I think that, yes, I start with Ronald Reagan because I think he is very much in this Protestant tradition of valorizing the individual, which I do think leads to problems if you have a nation of many different people, many different races, many different religions. And the fact that we, insofar as we are a de facto Christian nation, it also creates these polarizations and this, what do you call it when things fly apart? Is that centrifugal? Or
centrifugal.
The centrifugal condition we find ourselves in now where we cannot talk to each other as Americans, but we're always talking out of our own individual identities. So yes, I think you're exactly right that...
We got to consensus here, and I'll take credit as the moderator. Listen, we only have a few minutes left. I want to give the final word to the panelists. We're going to continue this conversation right after this is done, right upstairs, where we do a book reception, book sale, book signing. So this is a bit of a lightning round, maybe 2 minutes each here. All of you are great historians of religion, and all your books, in many ways, look to the past. But you are also scholars who think about how that shapes the contemporary moment. And we are coming into what will probably be the most contentious, divisive election of our lifetime in an environment with massive sort of media misinformation, AI, and deep fakes. We've never seen anything like we're about to encounter. Given what you study, given the themes of this conversation and your own sort of worldviews, what keeps you up at night going into this election, and what gets you up in the morning? And I want to end on the what gets you up in the morning. So where's, you know, what are you afraid of, and what gives you hope as we come through? And I know it's an impossible question in a lightning round, but we'll give it a shot, and I'll start with Dr. Winston. We'll work our way back.
What keeps me up at night is the fear of people not voting. And I call Trump's religious vision apocalyptic nihilism because I believe he wants to tear everything down and replace it with nothingness or meaninglessness, evacuation of all that is good in the world or all that brings us together. I think that we have a responsibility to get as many people to vote as possible. When I hear my students saying, there's no difference between them, they're both old white guys who don't get it, I think that, yes, on one level, that you could say that, but on another level, that's not true at all. Biden has a very different vision for America than Trump does. And I think it's important to remember that, because this election, I think, has the power to ruin us as a country, to possibly, you know, all of us are from non-Christian religions. And, you know, what is going to happen if white Christian nationalism becomes more of a force? You know, are we all going to be in internment camps? And what is going to happen to our ability to talk together and to solve problems and to protect our health and get vaccinated? I mean, it's impossible to think of all the ramifications of what will happen if people don't go vote. So that's what keeps me up at night. What gets me up in the morning is the belief that if I can make a little difference in all this, it's worthwhile. You know, Sherman and I were talking about promoting our books. And I feel the most difference I can make is by going out and talking about my book and trying to help people understand why we are the way we are, to also understand, and I didn't talk about this, the power of media. Yes, we have a very polarizing media now, but, you know, things were not great in the 1980s, in the period I write about. We had, you know, media presenting a lowest common denominator perspective of news so everybody would buy it, and we had people buying into the same position. One of my favorite anecdotes is a colleague of mine in Annenberg was at Time magazine, and when Reagan was elected, the reporters were meeting with the head of Time, and they said, well, what's our perspective on this? Well, you know, we have this guy, he's old, he's a former Democrat, he's been divorced, he makes lots of gaffes, how are we going to cover him? And the head of Time magazine said, well, we've already destroyed three presidents. Let's give this one a break. And he was referring to the media coverage of Ford, Carter, and Nixon. Yeah. And the media coverage helped bring those presidencies down. And he was saying, no, we need to, you know, take a positive spin on Reagan. And yes, we have a fractured media now, but then we had a media that, you know, men in charge wanted to dictate the way we understood those stories. So it's a long way of saying that I think I get up in the morning hoping I can do as much as I can, whether it's in my teaching or my writing or my book promotion, to help people understand the importance of their vote in this election.
Great. Thank you. Duncan, and we're going to have to keep it a little short.
All right. You know, so the basic Buddhist insight about how the world works is that we're interlinked. We're interlinked through time, and we're interlinked through space, we're interlinked with each other. And so the very same thing that makes things difficult, you know, that we would say from the Buddhist perspective that America, not just individuals, but like a nation, can have karma, you know? We have like a racial karma, we have other kinds of karma, but it comes down, all the positive things, negative things, whether we like it or not, we inherit it. But that very same thing, our interlinkedness, is what gives us the ability to impact. So I often get like, is it climate change, Professor Williams, or is it racial justice, or is it, you know, which... There's so many things, it seems so overwhelming. But if we understand that we're interlinked, any part of that web that we can impact to alleviate suffering, that's going to have an impact, not just in that moment, not just in that, but in a way that can transcend that one place and reverberate across communities, across times, and in our nation today.
And Dr. Jackson, you get the last word.
Very quickly, just two things. With all due respect to our European guests, one of the things that that worries me in a sense is the sort of the attempt to sort of re-Europeanize America, and by that I mean that we deny the fact that you don't have to be European or white to be Western, and that therefore that heritage is not the only heritage that's available to us to negotiate our issues among ourselves. That's the first thing that keeps me up. The second thing, and pardon my language here, I worry about America's descent into becoming a bullshit society. And I mean that not in the vulgar street sense. I mean it in the sophisticated Princeton University, Harry Frankfurt sense, who wrote